Good morning, everyone. And what a great day to be in the house of the Lord, huh?
Yes.
All right. Well, I'm assuming that now with the sound of my voice and our call to attention, everybody out there that's meandering in the foyer will make their way in. But as they do that, I want to share with you a couple of announcements. Actually, more than a couple. It's probably about six or seven, but who's counting? Things that are coming up in the life of the church. So first of all, if you'll recognize inside your bulletin, if you picked up a bulletin, and also on the backs of the chairs in front of you, there are some connection cards. We would really appreciate it if those who are worshiping with us would let us know who's worshiping with us. It really does help us to keep an eye out for each other, to know who's with us, to know who's been missing, and not because we're keeping a tally or keeping attendance or anything like that. But we just like to be able to know if we need to pay any special attention to somebody that might be out, maybe sick or something, and how we can connect with you and pray for you. Also, another thing that we're doing as well is we're updating our database on everyone's address and phone number. So if you are in the system, if you're in a database and you receive some of our mailings and information and literature from the church, I would encourage you also to fill that out. Make sure that we have your updated address. If you've already done that in the last couple of weeks, then that's okay. You don't need to do that again. But if we haven't, make sure that we have your updated email address and your updated mailing address. I want to remind everybody that this afternoon at 5 o'clock, we are anybody that comes along and myself are going to be having an open discussion and a Bible study on baptism. And I want to welcome anyone that has been considering baptism, that's been praying about it. Maybe the Lord has been prompting your heart to consider it, or you're not really sure what it's all about or what it means. That's a really good place to do it. It's very informal. Easy place to ask questions, an easy place for us to study what the Scripture says about baptism and how was it incorporated into our journey in faith. So anyone that would like is welcome to that today at 5 o'clock. Before next Sunday, on Friday night, Parents' Night Out. Anybody that's got little kids that they can't get out of the house for, am I the only one? Oh, you don't have little kids. Yeah. Well, Friday night, April and the children's ministry are going to be hosting a parents' night out where they're watching youngsters who aren't able to stay at home by themselves so that some of us can have a night out, preferably with your spouse. If that's something that interests you, there's a sign up on the bulletin board out there by the office. Let them know who all is coming along as far as kids are concerned so they can prepare for that. But also on Sunday, on the 27th, we got several things coming up next Sunday. One of those being that we're having April, our children's pastor, is hosting a VBS volunteers meeting. And this is for anyone and everyone who is interested in helping with VBS. And that should be all of you. Okay, yes. Everybody's interested. Good. Excellent. We need as many folks as possible. I mean, this is not just for partnership kids. This is a way that we reach out into our community, invite community kids along as well to come and to hear the Word of God. Do that in a fun, exciting manner and just have an opportunity to speak to them the life about Christ. So this is a way for all of us to serve our surrounding community and their children. Next week, plan to stay for volunteers meeting. Also next week is if you ride motorcycle. I used to ride a motorcycle when I had one. If you have a motorcycle or ride a motorcycle, or maybe if you want to ride a motorcycle, next week, Tammy and Richard Umstead are having a meeting about going to get a group together to do a motorcycle ride, kind of a fellowship group riding from here in Maryville down to Ellijay, Georgia. Stay after worship next Sunday to listen about the details on that. I want to make sure that we're always aware of our mission of the month. Now, here at Partnership, we support several missions, both local and international. And we try to highlight one of those each month. And this month we are highlighting Tim and Terry Hudson, who are serving in Kenya with Project Kenya. And there's several folks here at Partnership that are connected with that mission. We want to highlight them so that they are kind of first and foremost on our mind, on our hearts, so that when we pray, we can pray for them, we can pray for that mission and their work over there serving the people of Kenya. And finally, we are we're going to begin this morning singing up songs and lifting up our voices to the Lord. But there's other ways that we worship as well that we don't talk about all that often. We probably used to in the church, but we don't as much anymore. Another way that we worship the Lord is through our tithes and our offerings. And here at Partnership, we do that kind of incognito, I guess. We don't really pass a plate, but we expect that God moves in each one of our hearts what He has in store for us to give and to worship Him with by giving back to how He's blessed us. If God moves in your heart to do that, then there are boxes around the perimeter of the worship area to drop your offerings and your tithes. So as we begin this morning with song, and this is just a portion of our worship. Music is just a portion of that. I want us to be reminded of and have on our hearts and on our minds the beauty of a Savior and Lord in Jesus Christ. And this week, the next few weeks, have we been studying through the freedoms, the liberties, the state of goodness that we have through Jesus Christ and God. It's always wonderful to consider how much God has loved each and every one of us, and the promises that He's given us through His Son Jesus Christ. Last week we talked about that Jesus gives us He just gives us these certain conditions that we are promised that we can reside in, that we can find ourselves living in all the time. This week we're going to be talking about the state of freedom. That God has promised us a spirit of freedom through Jesus Christ. And it's only through Him, Jesus Christ, the way, the truth, and the life, that we have those freedoms. Won't you stand, if you would, with me? And I want us to think about what it is that Jesus has freed you from. As you've made Him your Lord, as you've made Him your Savior, He's offered you a condition of freedom. And Father, this morning as we stand in honor of You, Lord, as we lift up these words of praise, of worship, Father, I pray that that's what's first and foremost in our hearts and in our minds. Lord, the promises that You have given us through Your Son, Jesus Christ. Lord, that You have freed us, Lord, from the burdens of sin. Lord, that You freed us from anxieties, that You freed us from worries. Lord, and that You have freed us from so many other things that we're going to discuss this morning. But all through only Your Son, Jesus Christ. And we proclaim Him, Lord, this morning to be the way, the truth, and the life. That there is no other name by which we can be saved, that we can be free. Let's lift up these words to our Lord.
The way, the truth, the life, I believe You are. The way, the truth, the life, I believe You are. through every battle, through every heartbreak, through every circumstance. I believe that you are my fortress, you are my portion, you are my hiding place. Oh, I believe you are the way, the truth, the life. I believe you are the way, the truth. Every blessing, through every promise, through every breath I take, I believe that you are provider, you are protector, you are the one I love. 'Cause I believe you are the way, the truth, I believe you are the way, the truth, the light. I believe you are. And it's a new horizon. I'm set on you, and you meet me here today with mercies that are new. All my fears and doubts, they can all come too, because I can't stay alone when I'm here with you. And it's a new horizon, and I'm set on you, and you meet me here today that are new. All my fears and doubts, they can all come too, because I can't stay alone. I believe you are the way, the truth, the life. Yes, I believe you are the way, the truth, the life. I believe you are.
Up our voices this morning. It's much in the same way as those people did whenever Jesus entered Jerusalem, lifting up their hands, laying down the palm branches and yelling, "Hosanna, save us, free us, Lord." I think for every way that we have seen and that we read about in history, throughout those who have followed Christ in their lives, that there is a modern day, a current day expression of those things. And even as those people then would scream out, "Lord, save us," we too, even thousands of years later, need to scream out that very same thing. "Lord, save us. Free us, Father. We're unable to do it ourselves. We don't want to do it ourselves. We don't even want to try."
Stone unturned. Like snow, the sun.
forbear to shine. But God, who called me here below, will be forever mine. Will be forever mine. God, you are forever.
Father, thank you for breaking those chains, Lord, those chains of slavery for each one of us, for sin that bound us once no longer does, Lord, because of the freedom that we have in your Son, Jesus Christ. Lord, we are no longer bound. Lord, we are free, free by your grace. Lord, before we could do anything for ourselves, Lord, you offered us that grace and you called us to yourself. Father, we celebrate. We celebrate that this morning. We worship you for that this morning. We praise you for that this morning. God, I pray that all that we do is returned to you, Lord, in gratitude and thanksgiving for what you have done for us first through your Son, Jesus Christ. It's in his name I pray. Amen. Amen. Before you sit down, fooled all of you. Won't you take a second, if you would? I know there's a lot of times that we don't really get a chance to say hello to some of our closest brothers and sisters. Just take a moment and just welcome them in the name of Christ. And just encourage one another for just a moment, if you would. All right. Settle down. What's that? Oh, yeah. Hey, as everyone's settling back down and finding their seats, I want to remind our youth that they're going to have a class this morning. Go with bro, with bro, with bro, Bo. He's walking back there in the black jacket. There he is. All of our youth are more than welcome to. You're more than welcome to stay if you'd like, but probably more interesting conversation up there with them. If I were to say, celebrate your freedom, what would be the first thing that would come to your mind?
No kids.
No kids. Wow. No kids. Or just the word freedom, what comes to your mind? United States. What was that? Somebody said something?
Braveheart.
You know what? I got Bravehearted here. Hey, great minds. Our national freedom, oftentimes, Braveheart, William Wallace going, freedom! Let me see that.
The ability to pray.
The ability to pray. Amen. And that's actually my third thing. And you guys, did you read my notes or what? You know, God freeing us regularly from the burdens and the anxieties of life by giving us the ability to come to him in prayer. I mean, these are the types of things that really, whenever we think about freedom, I mean, sometimes that was what permeates our minds and our hearts, that we have these certain icons or certain symbols in life that we seem to gravitate to when we talk about freedom. You know, and I found this graphic, which I thought really symbolizes freedom as well. You know, thinking about the bird leaving the cage or jailbreak or slavery being emancipated, that type of freedom. And there's no doubt that those are good definitions of freedom and good thoughts to have on freedom. But particularly, there is there's a state of freedom that we all have been given in Jesus Christ that goes beyond just that moment, goes just beyond that emancipating moment or looking beyond a nation or looking beyond being able to pray in a moment for God to release us of a burden or an anxiety. There's a state of freedom. And as we talked about last week, this is a condition by which we live. It's a condition by which we reside.
And as we've been in this now 2 weeks in this message series called Enemy of the State, we recognize that the enemy wants to disrupt or interrupt these states being these conditions that we live in. He wants to interrupt those because it disrupts God's kingdom and it disrupts God's work. And most of all, it confuses the promises that God has given us through Jesus Christ. This week, I want to talk about the state of freedom and how Satan, the enemy of the state, seeks to interrupt or disrupt that state of freedom. Now, whenever we're going to talk about the state of freedom, we have to remember that there's a certain thing that we're talking about in that we are perpetually in the midst of, or we live under the condition of freedom. And that's the state of freedom that I'm speaking of. Well, what's the nature of our state of freedom in Christ? Well, our first one probably comes to mind pretty quickly is that we're free from sin. The freedom that we have from sin. You know, in Jesus' own words, he said, the Son, Jesus Christ himself, emancipated us from sin. He says, everyone who commits a sin is a slave to sin, and a slave does not remain in the household forever. But a son does remain forever. Therefore, if the Son sets you free, you really will be free. And this wasn't just a freedom that was given all of a sudden one time for one occasion. This is a condition of freedom, freedom of sin, that sin no longer reigns over you and I, those of us who call on Jesus Christ as our Lord and Savior. So sin no longer has reign over us. Sin doesn't dominate us any longer. Even the Apostle Paul reiterated in Romans, he said, we know that our old self was crucified with him in order that sin's dominion over the body may be abolished, so that we may no longer be enslaved to sin. Since a person who has died is freed from sin's claims. And what is sin's claims? What's the number one condition of sin that Jesus overcame? Death. Since a person who has died is freed from sin's claims. Now, if we died with Christ, we believe that we'll also live with him. Because we know that Christ, having been raised from the dead, will not die again. Death no longer rules over him. And for those of us who are in Christ, death no longer rules over us. Amen. And that's a forever thing. That's a forever condition. And because we're freed from sin, we're freed from death. But Scripture goes even further and he says, it's not just the fact that we're freed from sin. It's not just the fact that we're freed from the grave. But we're actually freed from what caused us to have to be put in the grave to begin with, and that's God's anger, his wrath towards our disobedience. Listen to what Paul says further in Romans chapter 5. He said, God proves his own love for us, so that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. How much more then, since we have now been justified by his blood, will we be saved through him from wrath? How many of us at one point in our lives have this image of an angry God? That God is just mad. He's mad at everything. He's mad at what I do. He's mad at what my neighbor does. He's mad at what the nations do. He's angry all the time. And to listen to some preachers and some speakers teach, you would think that God was just ticked off 24/7. But the fact is, that's not the case. Scripture tells us clearly that God's wrath was appeased. He's not mad at you. He's not mad at me. He took all that out on Jesus Christ. Isn't that freeing? To live with a God that is actually pleased with us, that's not angry at us, that we're not under the condemnation of sin, we no longer have to pay the punishment of sin because God's wrath has been appeased. Feel free of that this morning. And maybe that's for you. Maybe that's the word that you need to hear this morning. You are free from God's anger, from his wrath. Amen. Some of us need to hear that. Some of us need to recognize that God is not angry at you. He took his anger, he took his judgment out on Jesus Christ, so that we can be free of that wrath, that we can be free of that anger, so that we could be free from the grave, the product of sin. Now, the second condition of freedom that I believe that we also reside in perpetually is the freedom of choice. Freedom of choice. Now, your minds are probably wheeling, going, what in the world are you talking about? This has nothing to do with any social implications of abortion or anything like that. This is about our freedom to choose. You see, there wasn't always that way. People didn't always have the freedom to choose what they wanted for themselves. There was a time whenever people lived under the law and they had specific choices that were made for them. But now we live with a freedom of choice. Paul says in Colossians, when you died with the Messiah to the elemental forces of this world, why do you still live as if you belong to the world? Why do you submit to all of these regulations? Don't handle, don't taste, don't touch. How many of us have felt like sometimes the Bible is just full of don't do that? I mean, I know that I have. I've heard it described in so many different ways, a rule book. Don't do this, don't do that. But Scripture tells us that we have given this freedom of choice. In fact, Paul goes on to say in Romans that because of our freedom in Christ, one person believes that he may eat anything and still be pleasing to the Lord, while one who is weak eats only vegetables. For any of you vegetarians, there you go. It's okay. We'll call you the weak ones. That's out of context, by the way. That's not what that means. I just want you to be sure. One person judges one day to be more important than another day, and someone else judges every day to be the same. Let each one be fully convinced in his own mind. Whoever observes the day, whichever day that is, observes it for the honor of the Lord. Whoever eats, eats for the Lord, since he has given thanks to God. And whoever does not eat, it is for the Lord that he does not eat, and he gives thanks to God. You see, we're given this freedom of choice, what we understand as free will, to choose certain things in our lives according to our personal relationship with Christ, according to certain personal convictions that we have. You know, I've known people that have various convictions about how they go about their journey with Christ. But the truth is, we don't take those personal convictions and submit those to other people and expect that they also have to mind those same conditions, because it's a very personal thing. Just for example, one of mine is, and this is just my thing, I don't write in my Bible. That's just something that I've just never done. I have a very strong conviction about that. Now, I don't believe that anybody that writes in their Bible is going to hell. You know? But don't think that I'm, you know, Mr. Hoity-toity, because I don't write in mine. Okay? I've known guys that said that, you know what, I won't play golf on Sunday. I used to work with a man that we'd go play golf after church on Sunday, after worship. And he said, yeah, I don't play golf on Sunday. It's like, well, what? Now, he'll do other things, but for some reason it was just golf. And I don't know what that was. Maybe at some point he had this conviction that that he needed to step away from that particular event in his life to honor the Lord. Now, did I condemn him for that? And he condemned me if I went and played without him? No. So we have these freedoms of choice. You see, all of this came to a head. It actually was a perfect example of this was with the Apostle Peter. And the Apostle Peter in Acts chapter 10, he had gone up to the roof of the house. He was extremely hungry. Now, if you remember, the Apostle Peter was an Orthodox Jew, and he followed the Jewish dietary laws. He would not eat certain things that were listed in the book of the law that were called unclean. And he went up on the roof. He was starving to death. He was waiting on the meal to be prepared. And as he fell into this trance, this daydream, and he saw out of the heavens float down a sheet. And on this sheet was every living creature, all fish, all animals that had four legs, all birds of the air, reptiles, including animals such as pigs, which would have been considered extremely unclean to the Jewish tradition. And as he saw this sheet come down with all of these animals on it, he heard a voice from heaven saying, "Take and eat. I know you're hungry." And he said, "No, I'm not going to eat that. I've never eaten anything unclean." And the voice of heaven said again, "Take, kill, and eat. Don't call anything unclean that I've made clean." See, at that point, the Apostle Peter recognized that he had this freedom of choice that was given to him by an all-freeing Savior that had fulfilled the law of all of these rituals and dietary requirements. And the Lord opened up the possibility of so many other things, especially things to eat. You know, and we have that freedom to choose now. As long as whatever we choose is not harmful to ourselves, it doesn't harm our brother or sister, and it glorifies the Lord. I love this verse. This is one of my favorite verses in all of Scripture. Everything is permissible, but not everything is beneficial. Everything is permissible, but not everything builds up. No one is to seek his own good, but for the good of the other person. So whether you eat or drink or whatever you do, do everything to the glory of God. Paul is saying here that we have the freedom to do way more than we allow ourselves to do, so God will receive the glory and that we don't allow our brother to stumble. But we have the freedom to choose. We have the freedom that Jesus has given us in eliminating all of these rituals and rites that were handed down from the law. And that leads us into the final freedom, and one that God really has placed on my heart over the last several years. And that is this: is freedom from religion. Now notice, for those of us who are accustomed to the Bill of Rights, and we see freedom of religion, right? But I'm talking about freedom from religion. In fact, there's a lot of people that advocate for religion not to be proselytized to people in our nation because they say they want freedom from religion. I'm like, well, hallelujah, God has given us freedom from religion. God has given us Jesus Christ. And he was saying that, you know what, you don't need religion anymore. You just need faith in the one Son, Jesus Christ. You see, religion by definition, if you look at Merriam-Webster's definition, it's a personal set or an institutional system of religious attitudes, beliefs, and practices. You see, religion is defined as an institutional system of works and practices, of a bottled up group of beliefs and practices and attitudes that have to belong to everyone in the same religion. But if we compare religion with the freedom that we have in Christ, we go, you know what? A lot of those things are optional now. Christ has freed us from religion, and religion can get us into a lot of trouble. Whenever we have to stick to a particular work or ritual, or we have systematized our faith in such a way that we have to follow the system, more than we follow Jesus Christ, man, we can really hinder the gospel. Amen. And that's why Jesus says you have freedom from religion. Listen to this. This is a true article. I read, I don't just go around reading religious news, okay? I do actually read mainstream media news, and when I want the truth, I read the Babylon Bee. This was in a mainstream news outlet. An Arizona priest used one wrong word in baptisms for decades. They're all invalid. This is the truth. This priest used one wrong word, and that one wrong word was he said we instead of I. He said the word we instead of I. Every time he baptized, he used that one wrong word. And the institution of the Catholic Church says, well, all those baptisms are invalid. And who knows what you think about baptism. Some people may think that God's up there with one of those big kindergarten erasers in the Book of Life going, great, here we go. Got to get all this. From the article, it says the Catholic priest in Arizona has resigned after he was found to have performed baptisms incorrectly throughout his career, rendering the rite invalid for thousands of people. Thousands. And here is the kicker. In the Baptist church, because baptism is the sacrament that grants access to all other sacraments, then a botched baptism can invalidate any subsequent sacrament, including marriage. Oh my goodness. Now you got this influx of people that are, they don't know if they're baptized, they don't know if they're married, you got kids, they don't know if they're illegitimate. Do you see how religion can cause such headache in getting through the message and the freedom of Jesus Christ? There's a particular statement that Jesus made regarding religion, and it's out of Matthew chapter 11, verse 28 through 30. Now, there are a lot of uses that are made for this particular verse, a lot of references to it. But if you look at the whole of Matthew, especially the first portion of Matthew, on what Matthew talks about, he discusses the religion of the Pharisees, the do's and the don'ts, and the make sure you do it this way, to the freedom of faith in Jesus Christ. He compares the religion of the Pharisees to God's kingdom. He says, you've heard it said, do this, but I tell you, this is the truth in God's kingdom. And then out of that context of Jesus comparing the oppression, the religious oppression of the Pharisees, he makes this statement and he says, come to me, all of you who are weary and burdened, and I will give you rest. Take up my yoke and learn from me, because I am lowly and humble in heart, and you will find rest for your souls. For my yoke is easy and my burden is light. Now, for those of us that use that verse to recognize that we have a peaceful and an easy spirit in the Lord, I guess that's okay. It applies there. But what Jesus is really saying is all of these things that you've been burdening yourself with on trying to make yourself right with God, on crossing your T's and dotting your I's, on making sure that you do this and you don't do that, and you're following your religion, I'm here to tell you that there is a lighter load to carry. And notice that Jesus says, hey, I'm going to remove the yoke completely from you altogether. He just says, no, there's a lighter yoke. There's still a yoke. There's still an expectation that he has of us. But oh my goodness, it has nothing to do with trying to please him through all of the rituals and works all the time. You see, Jesus was merely advocating for the light burden of just being obedient to him. It's really, really simple. everything we need to know about pleasing the Father, we read in Jesus Christ's life. There's no secrets. There's no particular book, or there's no book of order. There's no particular bylaws. There's no specific, you know, there's no secret message behind anything. It's all right there, and it's accessible for each and every one of us. You see, Jesus said that this reward that we'll have for this lessened burden, it'll be this peaceful rest, this freedom from guilt, the freedom from the power of sin, and the freedom from having to self-strive our way into acceptance to the Lord. He says, you're never going to find rest trying to follow the religion, trying to adhere to and stick to the religion of the Pharisees. And in the same way, I think today, we burden ourselves with this systematic approach to our faith, to how we have to try to make sure that we pray this way, that we worship that way, that we worship in this place, that we sing these songs, that we either use instruments or we don't, that we make sure that we take the Lord's Supper in this manner, that we make sure that we, you know, do you see where I'm going? And all of a sudden we're just going, oh my goodness, can't we just follow Jesus? And Jesus said, yeah, that's what I've been trying to tell you all along. My yoke is easy, he says. There's freedom. There's a condition of freedom in Christ. And there's one final aspect of this freedom of religion in which we have been guilty of in Christendom with creating a form of religion around our faith. And I'm going to walk a thin line here, and there's a conversation I'm not willing to have at this stage. However, I want everyone to know that there are two things that I am absolutely convinced of in Scripture that belongs to every brother and sister in Christ. That God does not set apart a particular role or set apart a particular authority, because this authority is in Christ. And those two things are presenting Jesus Christ in the Lord's Supper and in baptism. Now, I speak in the midst of probably half a dozen ordained pastors, and it makes it a little bit nerve-wracking sometimes to stand up here whenever there are so many pastors that are in this place. But I believe that every one of them will agree that the ordination that we all had, before we were given it in the church, it was given to us in Jesus Christ. And that same ordination that was given to us in our obedience to Jesus Christ is also given to every single man and woman that have made Jesus Christ their Lord. But for some reason, there has been this expectation in the past that presenting Jesus Christ in the Lord's Supper and delivering the gospel message of Jesus Christ in baptism belongs only to a select few. And Jesus in nowhere states that. You see, we've placed these burdens on ourselves to try and make sure that we get people to the pastor. Try and make sure that we get people to a man to do certain things. Yeah. Ladies, I want you to hear me, and I'm going to say this as clean and as clear as I can. You have the authority in Jesus Christ to serve the Lord's Supper to anyone who comes in your presence that follows the Lord Jesus Christ. In fact, you have that responsibility. And I also want you to know that you have that responsibility to baptize. When Jesus gave his great commission, and he said to go forth to all the nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, teaching them all that I have taught, he didn't specify man, woman, he didn't specify Jew, Greek. He didn't specify slave or free. He says, if you follow me, this is your responsibility. Now, for some of you, that's a breath of relief. And for some of you, you all of a sudden got a little concerned. Jesus, in his own words, he said, Paul, in his own words, says, those of you who are baptized into Christ have been clothed with Christ. There's no Jew or Greek. There's no slave or free. There's no male or female, since you are all in one in Jesus Christ. And each one of us has the responsibility and the freedom to present Jesus Christ. What God has set us free in Christ, let's not return ourselves to the yoke of slavery. Sometimes we look at historically what Christendom and what the religion of Christianity has tried to teach us and tried to direct us and bind us to. But when we look at what Jesus has asked us to do, we find this freedom. This morning, as we take the Lord's Supper together, this was a meal that was open to all believers in Jesus Christ. And we all have the responsibility to keep Christ centered in our lives. We also have the responsibility to present Christ even in our households. Whenever we have a brother or sister in Christ that comes into our presence. Because this is what unifies us. That's what gave us the freedom. And the enemy wants to confuse that. He wants to say that the things that Jesus has freed us from, did he really say that? Do you really think that he meant these things also? For freedom, Christ has set us free. Stand firm then, don't submit again to the yoke of slavery. I believe that what Jesus Christ did for each one of us that he would be burdened, that he would be saddened to know how we burden ourselves, how we place the yoke of slavery back on ourselves for the things that he paid for to set us free. To the things that he entrusted to each one of us. This morning, I hope that this was a message of encouragement for many of us. A message that comes across to say that Jesus has given me a lot more freedom than I actually experience or that I allow myself to experience. What does that freedom look like for you? And if you have a question about a particular freedom that you feel God has given you in Christ, take it to the Lord in prayer. He will convince you through his Spirit on what that is, whether that's proper or not. But one thing I know for certain is what he's done for each one of us through his death, burial, and resurrection is free and open for us to give freely, just as it was given freely to us. It's because when Jesus died, when his body was broken, it was broken for all of those who call on him as Lord. When his blood was spilled for the remission of sins, it was done for all who confessed, who repented, and called on him as Lord. Father, I'm grateful for your meal. Lord, not just the meal that we have in our hands with bread and the cup, Lord, but the meal that comes from your word. Lord, that you have filled us in our spirit, Lord, with truth, with your expectations of each one of us. Lord, I pray that what you have freed us from, what you have given yourself to free us from, that we don't take those things back up and place chains around ourselves once again and make a mockery of the cross. Lord, what we hold in our hands, the body and the blood of Christ, are the keys to freedom. Freedom from sin, freedom to choose, freedom from religion, freedom, Lord, to follow you wherever you lead by the power and the authority of your Son, Jesus Christ, the one who is worthy. In Jesus Christ, I pray and thank you, Father. Amen. Let's eat together, shall we? Maybe this is a time of celebration for you, recognizing that the freedoms that Christ has given you, recognizing the liberty that Christ has afforded each one of us. Maybe this is a time of reflection and recognizing our responsibilities on what we should do with that freedom. Whichever one it is, let's spend some time in prayer and personal reflection on how God is speaking to us through the message of Scripture. And if you need prayer, and I want to invite you to come up, I'll pray with you. Let this be a time to honor the Lord and His Son, Jesus Christ. As we conclude this morning, I hope that we'll take this the same great message, this not message from me, but from God's word of freedom, and take it with us throughout our lives and our days. And I hope that it emancipates us in a bit, maybe takes some of the burden off of how we share the gospel, how we share Jesus Christ with our neighbors, with our family members. And gives us that encouragement, even in the Holy Spirit, to do the work that He's asked us to do, and recognize that Christ is with each and every single one of us in the same manner. The same Holy Spirit that fills me, fills you. And will give you the words to say whenever you need to speak them. That will give you the answers whenever you have a question about a choice. And that will guide you in all that you do throughout your life. If there are particular things that you need prayer for, I want to encourage you to fill those out in a connection card and leave those for us. We do pray each week together, a group of us, for all the prayer needs of the church. Want to make sure that we are covering our church family in prayer. There's going to be a special opportunity to pray. Pray for that right now. Father, I lift up to you your daughter. joy. Lord, you've heard her, the pleas of her heart, and Lord, the affliction that she has with this rash. God, we know that by your power and by your authority that you have in your Son Jesus Christ, the healing power that comes through him and the resurrected body, Lord, that you can and will heal things, Lord, that that you see fit, Lord, that bring you glory. Lord, we pray that you glorify yourself in this and heal joy, Lord, of this rash. Lord, I pray that above all, Lord, that that she lifts up your name and that she glorifies you, Lord, when this happens. Lord, that she thanks you for the work that you do, Lord, in her body as well as her spirit. Father, we give all the praise and honor and glory to your Son, Jesus Christ. It's in his name I pray. Amen.
Thank you.
Amen. But I want to remind us as well, and I've heard somebody say just recently that just the movement of partnership as a church family really has, really seems to have picked up over the past several months. And one of those things that was credited for that was prayer. I am an advocate for prayer, a diehard advocate for it, because I know that nothing happens outside of God's permission. And as a church, we will be a praying church. There's an opportunity for us to come together to pray on Good Friday. That's the next Friday night fight, we call it. We realize that our fight is not flesh and blood, but it's through the princes and principalities of the spiritual world, and that we pray for the Lord to fight our battles. That particular night will be a special night because we realize that it's the night traditionally that the church has recognized the crucifixion of Jesus Christ. It'll be the and subtitled the Last Hour, because it's also a time for us to come in personal repentance and confession and recognition of what Christ has done for each one of us. That'll be a special night of prayer. Please mark your calendars for that Friday night, Good Friday. That next Saturday, the very next day, is a fantastic opportunity for us as a church to reach out to our community, to love and to care for those that are going to be coming along to a community event here at the church and an Easter egg hunt. And really, the Easter egg hunt is just one way that we can invite families in so that we can bring them in close proximity with the Spirit of God and the goodness of Jesus Christ. And our prayer throughout those community events are that God's going to prompt us individually on who we need to speak with, who we need to pray for. And he's going to prompt those as well that are seeking to know God and seeking to know Jesus Christ to ask questions, to start those conversations. There's plenty of need for volunteers for that particular event. There's a table that's outside in the foyer. Hope that you will sign up to volunteer for that event. Again, this is something that we enjoy as a family of the church. But we're more intentional about ensuring that this is a place that we can love our community and love them well. So won't you stand with me as we conclude? I want to pray a blessing over you guys, but I mean, I ask the Lord that he blesses myself as well as your brother. God, you have been more amazing than words. Lord, your word, it speaks life, it speaks hope, it speaks purpose, it speaks freedom. Lord, I pray that what you have set free, Lord, that we no longer allow to be bound. Lord, that we allow the gospel message to flow out of our lips, out of our actions, to our neighbors, to our family, to our children, to our parents, our spouses. Lord, to all of those, Lord, that you bring into our proximity. Lord, may your Son, Jesus Christ, just emit from the very presence of us, because we know that the light of Christ resides in us. Lord, may we present Jesus Christ openly and freely. May we make him, Lord, a beacon of light to those that need him. And may we testify to the work that he has done in our own lives. Lord, recognizing that you are going to get the glory and you are going to get the honor. for all of those things. Father, bless us as we go. Make us bold for your word. Make us bold for your work. In Christ I pray. Amen.